All right, everybody, welcome back to our next lesson in our series on hemodynamics. In this lesson, we are going to be talking about the different ways in which we monitor or track our patient's hemodynamics. So to start off our discussion in monitoring hemodynamics, the first thing that we're going to talk about is our non-invasive forms of monitoring. Now, I know in this day and age with modern technology that we oftentimes rely on other ways to monitor our patient. But at its very core, hemodynamics has a direct effect on our body and our various body systems. Being able to assess and monitor things that are going on with your patients without the need for all the fancy technology that we have today will really make a difference in your nursing practice. And you won't always have, you know, all the different lines and ways of monitoring your patient's hemodynamics at all times in order to be able to tell what's going on with them. And one thing I've noticed is with some physicians, especially ones that have been around and have been doing this for a while, that when they come in and see their patients or they assess their patients, obviously they're looking at all the information they have available to them, but one of the most important things that they do is lay their eyes on their patient, listen to their patient, and feel their patient. And that's really the essence of non-invasive monitoring. It's that look, listen, and feel. You know, it's that going in there and actually looking and seeing what's going on with your patient that will really tell you all that you need to know. So later on, when we get into talking about some of the more advanced invasive forms of monitoring that we can do, sometimes the numbers that you see don't add up with the picture that your patient is presenting. So it's really important that you have a solid foundation of actually being able to go in there, look at your patient, assess them, and see what is actually going on with them, because it will tell you a heck of a lot more oftentimes than what your monitor will. So ultimately, when we're talking about hemodynamics and the flow of blood through the body, if we have some sort of compromise to that system, the end result of that is going to be decreased or lack of perfusion to the end tissues. And our ability to assess these changes that result are what make up our non-invasive monitoring of a patient's hemodynamics. Now, when we have decreased flow or decreased perfusion to various organ systems, they don't all just stop being perfused at the same time. The body has certain fail-safe mechanisms that it will put in place when it is faced with a situation where it's now having decreased blood flow, and the body will begin to shut off blood flow to certain parts of the body in a systematic approach to try and preserve perfusion for more vital organ systems. So when we start talking about decreased perfusion in the body, there are certain primary signs. Essentially, these are the first things to go. And these first things to go are going to be the skin and the gut. So in a state of decreased blood flow, the body's going to cut out the least important things first. And in this case, blood flow to our skin and even our GI tract is going to be very low on the totem pole in terms of importance of organs. So some of the signs that you're going to see with this are going to be cool, clammy skin. You could also see pale, ashen, or cyanotic skin. You're also going to notice decreased bowel sounds. Your patient could be exhibiting diarrhea or even constipation. And if they have an NG tube in place, you're going to see increased NG output. So if you think about the body is shutting down blood flow to the skin and the gut, these are the consequences the things that you're going to be able to visually, tactilely, auditorily be able to pick up on in order to sense that your patient is having an alteration in their hemodynamics. So if we continue to go along and the body has already shut off blood flow to the skin and the gut, and we continue to have problems with our hemodynamics, our blood pressure, the body's going to start going up the totem pole in terms of importance. So our secondary signs, so think of these as the next things to go. And these are going to be their kidneys, liver, and lungs. And signs that you're going to see that the body is beginning to shut down blood flow to these organs, you're going to see an increased respiratory rate and effort. Your patient may be short of breath. You may notice a decreased either PaO2 or decreased SpO2. You'll start to notice concentrated urine. You'll have decreased urine output. And then along with that, you'll begin to see a rise in your BUN, creatinine, and potassium. And then you may also see a rise in your ALT, AST, and an increase in your clotting times. So now with these secondary signs, the body's already tried cutting off blood to the skin and gut. That wasn't enough. So now it's cutting back or turning off blood flow to a little bit more important organs, our kidney, liver, and lungs. Definitely things that play an important role in our body's functioning, but if it's for a short period of time, they are things that the body can still function despite dysfunction in these organs. And so at this point, you know, it's saving all the limited blood flow and perfusion that the body has left for our brain and our heart, because without those, we've got nothing. So then that obviously leads us into our final signs. And as I already mentioned, this is going to be our brain and our heart. At this point, the body has done everything it could to preserve any last bit of perfusion to these two vital organs. And if perfusion is still not enough, then these are going to be the final signs that we see. So some things in here are either going to be a decreased or altered level of consciousness. You're going to notice disorientation. You're going to notice slow reacting pupils. Your patient may have either chest pain or chest pressure. Your patient may either be tachycardic or bradycardic. And along with that, they may also have ectopy. And finally, you may also notice ST elevation. And so you can see that from this list here, a majority of the things that are on this list, you do not need any fancy monitor or invasive line or anything special in order to be able to notice these changes. And sometimes these are changes that you may notice trends before you begin to see things on the monitor. So it's a habit that I've forced myself into. Like I mentioned, I've seen physicians do this as well. But if something seems off about your patient or they're just not doing well, along with looking at your numbers and your monitor, go in there and lay eyes, touch them, feel them, have a sense of what is actually going on, because they will tell you a lot. And a few last things to include in here with this non-invasive monitoring section. Obviously, all the patients that we have in the ICU are going to be on a cardiac monitor. They're going to have pulse oximetry, and we're going to have, at the very least, a blood pressure cuff in order to keep an eye on their blood pressure. So I did want to talk about our blood pressure just a little bit to give a little better understanding of what is going on with that. And our blood pressure is simply a combination of our cardiac output and our systemic vascular resistance. And that's how our blood pressure is calculated out. The important number that we look at with our blood pressure is going to be our mean arterial pressure. And your mean arterial pressure, or MAP as it's often referred, is really the most important number, because it's your number that tells you how much perfusion you're getting. So as you know, with your blood pressure, you have a systolic and a diastolic, but your MAP is the average across that full cardiac cycle, and this will determine if you're getting enough perfusion to your vital organs. And from patient to patient, there's going to be variations in what is an appropriate MAP or how much of a MAP is needed in order to perfuse their organs. But typically, we want to keep a MAP greater than 60, and this usually will tell us that we're perfusing in tissue. Now, just to give you guys a quick equation for the mean arterial pressure, it is more complicated than this, but there is a pretty rough and pretty accurate calculation that you can do, and that's if you simply take 2 times your diastolic blood pressure plus your systolic blood pressure and divide all of that by 3, that will roughly give you your mean arterial pressure. As you know, we spend twice as much time in diastole as we do in systole, so hopefully looking at this equation, it makes sense. And the last thing that I want to talk about in here is a concept that we call our pulse pressure. And our pulse pressure is a simple equation where we just take our systolic blood pressure and we subtract our diastolic blood pressure. And the whole point of the pulse pressure is to tell us or show us how wide or how narrow of a difference is there between our systolic and diastolic pressures. This will come in later on when you're looking at determining what is going on with your patients, whether they have a very wide pulse pressure or a very narrow pulse pressure, or one that's widening or one that's narrowing. And that can tell you a little bit about what might be happening with your patient as well. All right, well, that will go ahead and conclude this lesson on hemodynamics and more specifically our non-invasive monitoring. In our next lesson, we're going to take a look at invasive monitoring.